Wow. Good morning. This is the 8th day of July 2012. I have said that we need to make an all-out push right now. And of course, when we try to do that, we're going to lag a little bit. We're going to feel like we can't keep up the pace. So we need to find motivation to keep on moving. And boy, did I find it this morning. Triggered like bells. Bells are ringing. Earlier this morning, I raised. I saw the eye, what the eye is, the eye field, and the trouble with the eye. And it's hard to put it into words right now. But then when I got going on the day, I then also saw the means by which extreme oppression is going to come upon the world very quickly, very easily. In fact, it's already here. And if I told you about it, how it's going to happen, I would probably have my YouTube account, all my accounts deleted, be banned from the web. So I don't want that to happen right now. Let's just say that the internet is going to play a huge role in oppression. And that is why it's so absolutely crucial to wake up. There's lots of ways to talk about waking up. Unconditional love. You can accept unconditional love. Step into timelessness. See through the eye sham. Function. Start awaken to multidimensional functioning. It's all the same. It's basically talking about all the same. It's all a package thing. Unconditional love, multidimensionality, freeing from the eye delusion, unconditional love, perfect peace. It's all talking about one and the same. It's a package deal. So, and the necessity to go ahead and do that is so strong. Because the, wow. Incredible how oppression will come across this world. I mean, blatantly obvious, but I don't think anyone quite sees it yet. But the news is there. The dots are there to be connected. Very simple. But that's a side issue. I mean, it's pressure on everyone in this world. Everyone in this world is under the gun, right? Under the gun. No question about it. Basically, they're under their gun to adopt certain beliefs, and if they don't do it, they will simply be blocked access to the internet. They will be denied access. They will simply become non-entities, non-citizens, as it were, de facto, because the whole world is running through the internet now in a lot of ways. If you're denied access to the internet because of your beliefs, you know, your life can get very difficult in a lot of ways, because so much is going through the internet. Wow. And you know, people used to call us crazy when we said this worldwide oppression would come upon the world, and they say, how's that? Ridiculous, right? Nothing could have the power to do that. And they all assume, well, it must be the Catholic Church is going to do it because they're the only institution capable of it, et cetera, et cetera. Now, the internet is where it's going to happen. Those who control the internet are the ones who are going to bring it about. And, of course, with the best of intentions, right? There's no one who does more evil in this world than those with good intentions. The road to hell is paved with good intentions. That's why when they called Jesus good, he rebuked them very severely. He says, don't call me good, you know. That's not it at all. So don't do good. Awaken. Awaken to your true identity. Awaken to unconditional love. Awaken to multidimensional functioning. And you'll see that this I, when we're born and move into this world, we come across this I concept. And everybody pushes this I concept onto us and says, this is all important. You must cooperate with this I concept. And there, that's why sickness arises. I saw this morning, all sickness, depression, everything arises from interfacing with the I concept. We, it's imperative that we get free of this delusional, the delusion of existence. Existence itself is a delusion. Very important to realize that. It is an attempt. It is a drama. It is a distraction designed to enable us to forget what we are. And the I is sort of the centerpiece of this. Difficult to talk about. Someday I'll be able to talk about it very clearly. But it's imperative that we take all measures right now. Wow. All measures to awaken, to free ourselves from this I, to no longer engage it, to no longer chase after it, to no longer worry about what it's up to. And of course, all the teachings that have been given out, they all relate to this in some way. But we have to actually do it. Very imperative. It's one thing to consider it, another to do it. Now in this dream, the I ran off. It had been found out. It ran off and said, I'll be back. And I started to chase after it to keep tabs on it. And someone told me, no. Don't chase after it. Let it go. Don't worry. If you chase after it, it'll give the eye access to come back. Just let it go. Don't follow it. It's unimportant. There is definitely a way to be free of the eye concept and everything that eye concept entails. The eye that we think we are, our identity, the eye, that is simply the concept field that we came across as we came into this world. It's not what we are at all. It has nothing to do with what we are. But we were basically pressured into interfacing with this I concept. Now, in my case, I didn't really want to do that. But I felt I needed to do a little bit. And in doing a little bit, that's what caused the sickness. Those who interface with the I concept very strongly often have very robust health here. And those who really don't want to, just barely interface with it, often have extreme nervous problems, colds all the time, all these troubles. I saw that. When we drop interaction with the eye, let it go, health will return to us. It'll be even beyond health. It'll be complete freshness. All sickness comes from trying to interface with the I, which is another way of saying trying to forget what we are. But the I in this world is going to try to create its own kingdom here and banish the spirit, banish spirit, banish anyone that disagrees with its objectives, with its beliefs, and with its juvenility, with its irrelevancy, with its irresponsibility, with its frivolous and glamorous pursuits. It's going to shut out. It's going to shut out everyone who doesn't believe in that. But fine, as I've said, switch into multidimensional functioning, and you won't be shut out from reality. Being shut out from existence is not a bad thing. Please, shut me out, you know. If only the eye could actually do that, it cannot. But we can drop the eye. Drop our interface with the eye. Drop our interest. there have been those who have done that, and we can do it. In fact, we have to do it. And, wow. What I saw this morning lit a fire under me. Holy cow. Terrifying. Very, very frightening. The capacity now to simply ban you in many different ways, to delete you, to... whew. My gosh. And to allow activism, certain kind of activism, to not go after it, not try to stop it. And so there'll be a whole massive amount of internet activism and hacking, etc., which is not prosecuted and is seen as, you know, the revolution. The revolution that is coming is a digital revolution. It's not a revolution of mortal combat, as it were. It's a revolution of those who will use the internet to impose their own beliefs on everyone else, to coerce and intimidate them in that direction. And if they don't agree to it, they'll be hacked, their sites will be taken down, they'll be blocked, but it will be, the blocking and everything will be a massive movement. And a lot of the public will just agree with it, saying, yeah, we need to, this world needs to be a better place, and we need to silence those who don't agree with our vision of what is good. Of course, what is truly good is to wake up to our divine identity, our multidimensional functioning. That is what is good, and nothing else other than that is good. And what is taking place in the world right now, the world is being run by juveniles. Okay, you must understand that. The world is being run by juveniles. I know that's a chilling thought. The power is in the hands of juveniles. The internet's in the hands of juveniles. The mentality. No perspective. No depth. No wisdom. You know how juveniles can get, especially real smart juveniles. Imbalanced. Aggressive. The world runs through the internet, through digital technology. It's in the hands of juveniles. Think about that. Think about, oh, is that a good thing? No, it's not a good thing. It's in the hands of those who are serving the I concept. That's not a good thing at all. So there's a drastic need right now for awakening. I've been saying that and saying it, I've been saying it my whole life, that there will come a time when we have a drastic need for awakening. And the time is now. It's so drastic. If you saw what I saw, you would, like a fire would be lit. And it's an incredibly drastic need. We cannot waste any day at all now. And there's no need to delineate specifics. It's enough to have intuition. You'll figure it out. Bottom line is, awakening is all important. And we have our intention there. There's a feeling. Like right now, I've got a feeling of intention. Maybe you can feel that. It's, it's like a smoldering, you know, intensity. Yeah. We're under the gun. Really, society is under the gun. The world is under the gun. We just And each one of us at some point will see this. I just saw it this morning. It's reverberating through me right now. Oh my gosh. Monstrous. And so, we don't waste time complaining about it. You know, we have to use that as motivation to awaken, to free ourselves from the I concept, to abide in unconditional love, to function multidimensionally, to experience complete refreshment. And that will enable us to move into function as we were created to function. And all of the juvenile techies in the world cannot touch us at all. Okay, reality is not digital. It's not even based on energy. There's no coercion in reality. Everyone's perfectly free to experience. There's no bodies in reality, by the way. Spirit is formless. Everything and nothing. Neither everything nor nothing. And not that either. It's beyond our imagining. From a form-based platform, we cannot imagine what we really are. Because it transcends the what. And we are the totality. We are the oneness. We are the experiencing. We are the oneness experiencing itself in infinite flow and variety. But all of it in essence, not in energy. I saw this morning how we projected the whole universe. Literally saw it as no big deal. It's very simple. Very simple. We can project infinite suns, galaxies, solar systems, stars, gas. Easy. I mean, don't be overwhelmed by the number of stars. You know? Oh, they're trillions? So what? I imagine they're trillions of grains of sand, you know, on beaches around here. Zillions? Doesn't matter. I saw how we projected all of the universe this morning. And it wasn't like some big wow or anything. No, it was very simple. Completely obvious. No big deal at all. Guarantee you, no big deal. I just said, okay. Just watched it. And I saw how we interface with this forgetfulness, how it comes out as these separate bodies, you know. Planets, stars, and these bodies, gas, particles going into stars, into planets, and et cetera, et cetera. All this dream of fragmentation, of separation, of trying to forget what we are. It just simply projects this universe. Very simple. Let me see if I can take this effect off and see what it does. Okay, that's a little smoother. It's getting kind of jaggedy there. Let me brighten things up a little bit. All right, very great. There you go. Okay. Yeah, so literally saw this the universe being projected and realized the universe is nothing. Just a projection of our belief in being able to separate from reality. It's not a big deal. And let me keep brightening this up somehow. Okay. Nope. Okay. You know, these seeing things, like seeing the eye, how the eye arises, how we interface with how sickness arises, how the universe is projected, all these things. You might think, wow, those are mind-blowing insights, incredible. No. Now it's just ho-hum, kind of like, oh, okay, I'm seeing it. No big deal. Not a surprise. And doesn't, you know, change my functioning during the day. Doesn't do anything, really, except to say, oh, okay, I better take a closer look at that. Or if I can see that again, it's not a problem. So these insights are there, simply there, if our intention is to get there. We projected the entire universe, but it was not a complex thing to do. Automatically, this happens when we try to change what we are. Automatically. So we're not, you know, we're not lost in time and space the way we think we are. Because just an insight can show us how this, why this arises, all of this arises. And then you realize that, you know, you are simply causing it to arise because of choosing, trying to try to change reality. So you can change what we are, change and become prime creator. That's the origin of all our troubles. And once we're able to see it from that standpoint, then these so-called big insights become just ordinary insights. They fit right in. Don't have to make anything of it, really. I mean, you just see it and you don't have to make anything of it. You say, okay, I see it. Great. There you go. Game, set, and match. It's over. I don't have to go write a book, you know. I just see how the whole universe was projected. I don't have to go write a book. Don't have to do anything about it. The answers are simply there for anyone to see. It's easy. Simple when you are willing to look at it. So really, it's just a willingness. It's not an intellectual thing so much, really. Really, we need to wake up from this dream of a universe, as the universe doesn't want you to wake up, believe me. Those who are dreaming, they want everyone to dream along with them, and they'll do everything they could possibly think of to bring that about. Because why? Because they look around, they say, oh, everybody's dreaming, so I got to keep dreaming also. It's a way to keep themselves dreaming, is to make sure everyone else is dreaming. Which is why existence always goes toward totalitarianism, fascism. Always. Dictatorship. Brave New Worldism, Orwellianism. It always goes in that direction. Because those who are dreaming, they're terrified of waking up. They think if they wake up, they'll be annihilated. So they make every effort to make sure everybody else is dreaming. So there's nothing else, no other option. And they look around and say, I don't see any other option. And that makes them feel safe. Makes them feel safe. So the idea of tolerance in this world is just an ideal that is rarely touched upon and never maintained. The world that we're going towards actually is a world of intolerance, extreme intolerance. In the name of tolerance, of course, because if they realize they're being intolerant, they might have second thoughts, and then they might look for other options, and then they might see a waking up as an option, and then be, you know, I'm terrified. That's how it works. There's a vicious circle. When spiritual inquiry is undermined, when we talk about religions and spirituality, all this stuff, we're talking about inquiry. We talk about inquiring into existence. Deep inquiry. Not dogma. Not talking about dogma. Of course, the religions have dogma. But that's superficial. I mean, real religion is inquiry. Deep inquiry. And sure, people can go to church and sit there and think they're being good. But That's not it. It's inquiry. Which is what we're doing right now. But these videos are their inquiry, okay? You have to dig deep into it. Find out what existence really is. Find those who know. Listen to what they say. So, the great effort to undermine religion and spirituality, etc., that's been going on now for quite some time, is really an effort to stop inquiry. Stop inquiring. Stop digging into issues. What the totalitarians want is they want to tell you, dictate to you, the right position on all issues. Without any inquiry, they want to impose it upon you. Saying, this is right. This, and anyone who doesn't believe this is a very bad, wicked person. And they don't want to give any reasons for it. They want to claim that it's all self-evident, that only a wicked person cannot see this. And therefore, no inquiry is needed. So basically, the motto of this new world order that's coming is no inquiry is needed. They say, we know all the answers. These are the answers. This is how to be a right society. This is how a right society, these are the beliefs a right society has, a just society. And there's no need to inquire into anything. Case closed. They'll close it. So, no more inquiry. If you're inquiring, they're going to say, you're crazy. You have a mental disorder if you're inquiring. If you say, wait a minute, let's just weigh this on the scales. You know, let's take a closer look at it. And start digging into this. They're going to claim that this is mental illness. Literally, that is a fact. And they're going to put you into re-education places, medication places, places to root out this desire to inquire, to challenge authority, to challenge the conclusions of the righteous. You know, however the righteous. I'll tell you who the real righteous ones are, the ones who encourage inquiry. I'm not the slightest bit afraid of anybody inquiring, deep inquiry into existence. Go for it. Whatever side of the spectrum you're on, go for it. Whatever your beliefs are right now, go for it. Inquire into everything. Inquire deep down, you know. What is existence? What's the purpose? Why are we here? What's our identity? Did God make all of this? Where did it come from? You know, big questions, big inquiry. And go for it. Everybody, I don't feel the slightest bit threatened in that in any way, because I know you'll start finding some answers. Now, you may not get it right initially, but it's a process. Inquiry is kind of like you're digging a hole, you know. You haven't hit the treasure box yet. You know, there's this box of treasure, buried treasure, and you're digging a hole. And just keep digging, eventually you're going to get there. But the world, now the totalitarians of the New World Order, the Internet Inquisition is with us, and it will say no need for any inquiry. It's all settled. It's all been settled. And time to, you know, and they'll say, well, the economy, we all got to work together. You know, we all got to get along together, and we've got to feel comfortable together. Inquiry is not a necessarily a comfortable thing. You've got to be able to honor discomfort. I came across something amazing on the internet. It was in the background. Someone was making a video. Oh, I know what it was. Oh my gosh, yeah. Some student was making a video in the classroom. And I heard the teacher in the background teaching, and I couldn't believe what I was hearing. And what they were doing is they're teaching people to take offense and saying, I'm offended at this, and how to be offended, and how to be... and how to pursue the right ways to pursue legal action, to pursue intimidation, to assert, to stamp out whatever was offending them. It's incredible. We are literally have cultivated a globe full of Nazis, little Nazis, okay? Worse than that, actually, where they've been groomed, okay, to... take offense at what the authorities say you should be offended at. You should be offended. And they believe that by taking offense, they're being a very good citizen. And they're going to reap the benefits of being a good citizen. Now, they'll take offense at whatever the authorities tell them to take offense at. The thing is that they have been taught how to persecute and prosecute and bully and intimidate those who they claim are offending them. You know. Well, if you want to take offense, you can take offense at anything. If I wanted to get into a mood of feeling offended, I could get offended at anything. I could get offended if somebody interrupted this satsang. I could get offended at the neighbor's dog, right? I could get offended at cars going up a street. I could get offended at a whole lot of stuff. In fact, I could probably find things to take offense at everywhere. Instead, when you're doing inquiry, it's so important you don't take offense at anything. Okay? You don't even take offense at those who are taking offense at everything. So, inquiry is tolerance. What does tolerance mean? Don't take offense. Don't be offended. Refuse to be offended or uncomfortable or whatever, no matter what. Let everybody have their opinions. That's true freedom, true tolerance. Don't take offense. You know, my generation was raised, to not take offense at anything. I mean, that was, you know, we were called names. If we took offense at something, we were called names, really. And the only thing that we turned away from was the attitude of taking offense. You know, that was bad. Okay. And it is very, very something you want to avoid at all costs. Let's put it that way. We don't take offense at it, but we avoid it at all costs because it's the enemy of inquiry. What I found is that people taking offense, they're not doing any inquiry at all. Why? Because they might not be, if they do inquiry, they may not feel so offended. Right? They might say, well, you know, there are pros and cons to everything here. That's not to say that we're saints, you know. Some stuff we don't like, of course. We have opinions of what is best for society and what is harmful to society. That's the dialogue in a free country. There's always a dialogue of, you know, what is truly best for excuse me. Sneeze. Okay, what is best for society? What furthers inquiry, real inquiry? And what is aiming towards stifling inquiry? What is aimed at dictating to us what is right? What is telling us that we're bigots, or we're racists, or we're sexists, or all these pejorative terms, if we don't automatically 100% agree with the position? Well, of course, when you inquire into anything, you're going to see the good, the bad, and the ugly, right? And you're not going to be 100%er on anything in existence. It's not possible. In fact, you're going to say that existence itself is nothing. It's a fantasy designed to get us to forget what we are. It's a vicious, death-faced, fear-based, glamour-based, delusional, distracting, hypothetical scenario. That's all existence is. So you will eventually see that. And of course, the ego doesn't want you to see that. So it tries to stamp out inquiry altogether. It wants to cultivate this totalitarianism where you have to be 100%er. And totalitarianism is like everybody's 100%ers. There's no questioning. There's no questioning the premises that the Politburo gives. The central party says, this is what you're supposed to think, these are the attitudes, and everybody get with it. If you don't get with it, you're in prison. You're in a work camp. And it's exactly what's happening on a global scale right now. The casualty is inquiry, which is why I'm saying it's so important to finish your inquiry right now. So there's no... Even if they say there's no inquiry, it's okay because you've already completely shed delusion. You're awake to your identity, to multidimensional functioning, to unconditional love, to the vision of oneness. Very, very crucial. Because time is, the noose is tightening, big time. It's, you know, it's simply ridiculous. When I grew up, we were allowed to disagree with one another respectfully and have different opinions, and we listened to different sides and say, that's interesting. I didn't see that. And how about this? I said, yeah, oh, I didn't see that. And we just go through a process of kind of digging into it, you know, and say, wow, there's a lot of stuff I haven't seen, pro and con. And what does that do? It means you're not an extremist, right? Inquiry makes you not an extremist. You kind of feel like an independent. You feel independent of extremism, of self-righteous extremism, of saying that, you know, we are right and you are wrong about issues of existence. The fact that inquiry eventually leads us to is the origin of existence. And that is not a matter of an opinion. That's a fact. So the inquiry is really concerned with facts. And if something is not factually based, then inquiry just, you know, why even bother with it? But all of the dogma, the social dogma that's being forced on the world now, is not fact-based at all. It's merely emotion-based. Saying, we want this, therefore we should get it. Whatever we want, we're supposed to get, and anybody doesn't let us get that is evil. But it's not, there's no facts involved in it at all. Facts don't matter. Facts don't matter to a mob, okay? But inquiry is concerned only with facts. And if there's no facts around a situation, you know, forget it. Find facts. Fact, you know, our identity. Prime Creator is a fact. Spirit is a fact. The fact that Spirit chose to try and change reality is a fact. That existence arose from this attempt to change reality is a fact. The purpose of existence is for us to be in a state of forgetfulness of what we are is a fact. The fact that we are projecting all the universe, that's a fact. The fact that we can awaken from this dream is a fact. The fact that we must awaken eventually is a fact. The fact that not awakening is just a delay, that's a fact also. You see, inquiry leads to a lot of facts. In fact, you dwell in facts, not emotions, not opinions, not movements, not even justice, but facts, real facts. Not invented facts, not statistics. All right. The Central Committee will say these are the facts that we want, that everyone has to agree to follow. They're just opinions. There are no facts there at all. So only those who engage in inquiry find facts. And finding facts is a wonderful, great, great thing. You know, seeing the universe, you know, being projected, I say, okay, it's just a fact. I'm seeing factually how it is. I don't have to do anything about it. No emotion was involved at all. I didn't feel any emotion. I just was observing it. Say, okay, I'm observing a fact. This is how it is. I saw the interface with the eye concept. That's just a fact. There was no emotion. Emotion is the enemy of inquiry. Really. And in inquiry, no matter what you see, you should sort of remain kind of neutral. Because as soon as emotion arises, you get all emotional, you get opinionated, you feel like you need to push it off on others, and you lose your clarity. Inquiry ceases. You're not seeing any facts. When you see a fact, you don't need interpretations. You don't need to dwell in interpretations, which means you don't need to dwell in disputes. No disputes. When there's real facts, there's no need to dispute. And you don't need to force anybody to believe what you believe, because disbelief doesn't threaten facts. Okay, faith in lies doesn't threaten truth. Belief, faith, concepts, and lies doesn't matter, doesn't threaten truth one bit. It's just a delaying tactic. It's a forgetting of truth is all. All we're doing is we're temporarily in a state of forgetfulness. That is it. Everyone, Same boat, exactly the same boat. And the means of maintaining that forgetfulness, you know, those means continue on and on and on and on. And we're entering a phase now with very determined forgetfulness. Forgetfulness is taking a turn for a very determined manner right now in the world. Iron-fisted forgetfulness is upon us. I look at the internet, go through all the comment sections, all the articles, everything. There's no inquiry. I don't come across anyone, any spirit of inquiry on the internet whatsoever. With, you know, obviously, there are minor exceptions. So, but I need to make an absolute statement like that just to, you know, wake us up. I mean, this channel right here is, of course, a spirit of inquiry. But it's, you know, it's on the internet, but not of it, you know. I mean, I don't have any power on the internet, really. No control of anything. But you know what I mean. Read all the comments, okay? The dialogue, the interplay, etc. It's not really a spirit of inquiry there. Because inquiry is only interested in getting the facts. And so inquiry will say, well, is that a fact? If we say no, then let's not argue about it. Let's dig deeper. Is this issue factual based? No, let's go dig deeper then. And so you know, you have people on one side of an issue and people on the other side of an issue, but all their emotion and stuff is not based on facts, neither side. So why even make that an important issue? It can't be resolved with facts. Only facts bring resolution. Opinions bring tyranny. And it's simply those who have got the means are more ruthless and have the means to impose their opinions on others. That's what makes up history. That's what's called history. Look at history on this planet. What is history? It's simply those imposing their will, their opinions on others based on their capability to do so and using any and all means to accomplish this. And so you have these enormous struggles and battles. Right now, the means to do this is the internet. It's digital technology. So that's what will be used, utilized. You know, every weapon that's ever been made has been utilized, right? By those who want to impose their opinions on others. Every means of power has been used. So, of course, the internet is going to be used that way. Of course. No question about it. It's already being used that way. But it will come on strong very soon. So, where does the spirit of inquiry have to stay in this world? You know, Jesus said there was no... There's no place at the end for his parents. He said there's no place to rest his head here in this world. Is there any place where a spirit of inquiry is really welcome? I haven't found it. You have to make it welcome within yourself, right? Out in the world, you're not really going to find it. Very, very rare. Inquiry is trying to get to the facts. That's all that it's interested. It's like a dog digging for a bone. You know, the dog smells it, it's there. And that dog doesn't want to stop for anything. The dog says, I know that bone is there. I just got to keep digging. Inquiry knows facts are available. And it knows it's got the dig to get there. It can dig into it and get there. So, you know, that this morning, okay, I got there, and just inquired, just said, okay, here's some facts, very good. And of course the I goes running away, doesn't want to see any facts. I doesn't want to see any facts. When you see facts, the I is going to flee from you. It's not interested in facts. It's interested in everything but facts. Because the fact is, that the I is temporary. That existence is temporary. That's a fact. Yet this so-called quasi-authority of existence is really nothing. No authority at all. It's only temporary. How can that which is temporary be a real authority? has to see this authority at some point. So it's not a real authority, just a caretaker of a dream, caretaker of forgetfulness. The eye is just a caretaker. It's nothing more than that. It's just a silly deceiver, a focus, a false focus, saying focus here, every time you try to focus there, it moves again, it says focus here, and just keeps your focus shifting and changing all the time, like a shadow, you know, move. Is it really anything at all except just the activity of self-deception? That's all it is. It's not an identity. The I is not an identity at all. It's the activity of self-deception. It's the activity of forgetfulness by constantly searching in opinions instead of looking at facts. Inquiry then brings us back to looking at facts. And again, the spirit of inquiry is not alive in the world, not alive on the internet. It's being stamped out. Which is why, again, we need to realize the I is simply the dance of deception, distraction. It's sort of the means we're using to search in opinions and not look at facts. Even if opinion states a fact, it's doing it from the standpoint of an opinion, which means it's not clear. It'll vacillate. It's a dogma. Dogma, it has no depth to it. It's an opinion. Inquiry brings facts. You know, the preacher, the priest, the rabbi, the guru can state something as dogma, and it's conceptually accurate, but it's not seen through inquiry. It's not seen as a fact. It's an opinion that's accepted as fact, but it's not seen as fact. It's we're relating to it on the level of opinion, and we don't disagree because someone an authority has told us this. But within we feel, wait a minute, I'm not seeing it as fact. I'm not being encouraged to actually look at it. Of course, by looking at it, you bring up the possibility it's not a fact, right? And you can't be afraid. You can't be afraid of looking at all dogma on whatever is side of the aisle the dogma is coming from. There's all sorts of dogma in the world. I tell you what, all that's happening in the world is people are slinging dogma at each other. That's it. All sides are just slinging dogma. There's no spirit of inquiry. There's nobody sitting down and say, hey, you know what? This is all dogma. Let's find out what's really true. Let's bring all sides up into the light and see what we can see. Because it's facts we need. Whatever the facts are, we have to see it as fact. We have to know it's a fact. Otherwise, we're just tilting our windmills or spinning our wheels. We're just dealing in opinion. Where is that? Where is that? That's what a guru does. I remember one of my gurus, Anandamayi, was at the Kumbh Mela in India. I can't remember, what year was it? I don't know, 58 or something, in the 50s. And there was a lot of warring factions among all the different spiritual traditions there. And there was trouble, a lot of hostility and anger, and wasn't good. So what she did, she had a big tent there. And she invited all the heads of these different factions, religious traditions, into her tent there. And she just had satsang there and just hung out with them. Laughing, smiling, welcoming them, and sitting quietly. And by the time they left the tent, they had completely forgotten what they were disagreeing on. Completely forgotten. Because they were in the presence of fact. Of someone who knew the facts, and there was zero doubt there. It was complete certainty, and they felt that, and they realized, oh my gosh, our whole purpose of spiritual teachers is to focus on facts, not on opinions. And here we are squabbling over interpretations. That's not what we're supposed to be doing. I mean, we lost our minds there, you know. We need to, in a spirit of inquiry, promote the spirit of inquiry, promote the inquiry towards real facts, ultimate facts. And so they left at peace with one another. And, you know, how long that lasted, I don't know. Maybe several days or several weeks or longer, I don't know. But the truth is that when you sit with a real guru, a real teacher, a real savior, you realize that facts are real. They're there. And there's no disputing facts. And that's where peace of mind is really found. When you dwell in facts, you also dwell in peace of mind. And the whole goal is to inquire into facts and find the real facts. And if you're not doing that, you're going to end up in disputation and disputes, which the internet is full of. And of course, the internet is just people interacting with one another. They're just at the level of disputes, disputation. And it's not just getting out of hand, it is out of hand. And that's when the central authorities will come in and say, you know what, we need to end this dispute. So let's just, we're going to impose a opinion and just call it a fact. And then most people say, yeah, you know, we really need to all pull together right now. So I think we just need all of us. We're not really, even though we're not sure what the facts are, they'll say, well, nobody can know. That's the spirit of the I, the ego, will say that nobody can know. What the ego is really saying is there's no such thing as facts, only interpretations. Which is correct if you're only interpreting illusions. But what about the question of where do illusions come from? See, that's a fact. Find out where they came from, and then you'll see that is a fact. It's not an interpretation. So the central authorities will say, we need to stop all this squabbling, so we need to decide on what is true, what we decide is true for us. And then everybody has to, that's it, no more argument over this. That's what'll happen. And most people will accept it, realizing, okay, you know, because I know I'm not sure if I'm right, I don't know if they're right, but in order for the greater good, to be a good person, I'm going to go along and accept what the central planners want. This happens all the time in history. It's happening right now. It's going to happen. It's inevitable. When the spirit of inquiry is lost, totalitarianism is inevitable. It's a certainty. It's either the spirit of inquiry or totalitarianism. Those are the only options there are. Well, combat is a temporary option, but combat generally doesn't last that long. There have been some times, you know, 100 years of war and stuff, where there's been a lot of conflict lasting a long time, skirmishes, etc. But generally, overt conflict, it flares up and it burns itself out like a wildfire. Wildfires don't last forever. So that's where we're at. That's really where we're at. And the spirit of inquiry has been undermined for a long time. Popular culture has done a great job at that. Everything that termited did a very effective job. And you can't spend your time in viewing frivolous entertainment. That's not inquiry. Inquiry is taking a... I would just sit very quietly like here, you know. I would just sit like this. Open eyes. You can have eyes open or closed. Doesn't really make any difference. I'm not even paying any attention to what my eyes are seeing. And I'm looking at thought processes. And whatever I notice in the process of my thinking, of my believing, and you become aware of all these little tactics and tricks and inconsistencies, and you catch them and say, whoa, what's that? You just sit there quietly, not have any particular intention whatsoever. You're just watching, just observing. Not observing the world, observing your thought processes, your reactions, your emotions, your opinions, your beliefs, and not even trying to come up with anything in particular, but just taking a close look at the lay of the land and saying, you know, what are the facts? Also feeling like I want to clarify, I want facts. And you just can sit there doing that for hours and hours and hours at a time. And that's what I did, you know. That's inquiry. There's various ways of inquiry, but also when you wake up, you're not sleeping well, you wake up, you're in sort of a half-awake state, you can do a lot of inquiry then. You can pay attention to what's going on. Oftentimes, dreams will point out very important facets of your functioning, of your belief systems, as it did this morning, and often. We want facts. Inquiry brings facts. Totalitarianism brings imposition of opinions. It ends inquiry. It only lasts a while. Totalitarianism doesn't last because people eventually say, hey, you know, these aren't facts. You know, we're suffering. This is horrible. What about the other side of things? You know, this is just our arbitrary imposition. And, you know, this is a question. Younger generations come along and they question all this authoritarianism, and they dissolve it at some point. And then they go on to impose their opinions. And maybe sometimes a generation may turn towards inquiry. My generation was somewhat engaged in inquiry. There was some of that. And we are much less totalitarian. I say the people, you know, 50 and over tend to be much less authoritarian, totalitarian, and are more prone to inquiry. You know, to say, well, my mind's not made up. If you ask them, you know, what's your belief, what opinion on this issue, they'll say, well, you know, my mind is not made up. I'm open to looking at it and discussing it, and, you know, but I haven't reached a, you know, factual conclusion on this. Much more prone to that. If you ask the younger generation, again, generalization, not everyone is like this way at all. There's a lot of older fascists too, but no question about it. And there's a lot of younger people who are have a spirit of inquiry too. But, you know, generally speaking, if you ask a young person about an issue that, you know, wow, you get this ferocious, adamant position that is not open to question at all. They think they're dealing in facts. What they're dealing in is learning opinions and adhering to opinions, like good little communists, you know, good little Nazis. You know, they're taught what to think, and they've learned what to think, and they think that this makes them right in the eyes of, you know, authority. So you don't get this feeling like, well, I don't know. You know, if when someone asked me a question, you know, growing up, I'd say, I don't know. I really don't know. I'm going to have to, you know, dig into it, inquire into it. I still don't have a position on social issues, because social issues are not really factual based. It's open to all sorts of interpretations. You know, they're good, they're bad, and they're ugly. They have upsides, they have downsides. They're not anything to stake a claim of righteousness on whatsoever. We're not dealing with absolutes. We're not dealing with facts. So I say, well, I don't really have a factual position. And since I don't have a factual position, it's not a real position at all. And therefore, what's important is to find real facts. And when you go find real facts, you find out real facts encompass all of existence. And they say all existence is just a dream. It's all a zero. It has zero effect on reality. It's an attempt to block out the fact that reality cannot be changed. It's an attempt to deny reality. So therefore it's nothing. Reality is not affected by any denials. So it's really nothing. Temporary, it's temporarily nothing before it's seen as forever nothing. We're thinking that nothing is temporary and that eventually it will become something. But no, nothing right now is temporary and eventually it will be eternally nothing. It already is eternally nothing. We just don't see it yet. So listening to someone with facts is different than listening to someone with emotions and opinions stuff. I was watching a video of Krishnamurti last night, and several reactions I had, I looked at it and I said, wow, he really encouraged inquiry. That's what he was all about. He encouraged a spirit of inquiry. Wonderful. Wonderful at that. He was just fabulous at that. He said, sir, let us look at this very carefully with the totality of our awareness. And let us see if we can find facts here. You know. And it is wonderful about that. Now, in today's day and age, of course, we're coming across differently than Krishnamurti came across, but the fact is that he promoted inquiry. Very important. And there's a generation of people that listened to him, intellectuals, etc., who caught the flavor of this inquiry, which went on to a lot of, you know, spiritual flowering in this world. But the digital revolution is coming on strong. Okay, we didn't quite bargain for that. Krishnamurti was aware of it. He says called automated thinking. Okay, mechanical thinking. He was completely aware and warned us of this artificial intelligence. All this stuff was coming. And he said, you better find out facts now, because later on you won't be able to inquire. Okay, and he's right. He saw it. Tremendous awareness for someone to see that clearly what the future was. He wasn't speculating, he was seeing it. He was aware of it because he had this spirit of inquiry, tremendous spirit of inquiry that was focused on facts. And so, you know, we had those great influences during these times, the 50s and the 60s and the 70s. And then that's when the digital revolution began to kick into high gear. And people said, what do we need facts for when we can impose opinions on everyone? You know, it's the lazy man's guide to quote-unquote enlightenment. It's this digital revolution, it might be said, it's the lazy man's guide to enlightenment. It's simply find a way to impose an opinion on everyone in the world, and we don't even need to worry about facts. Don't need to do inquiry. All the hard work of inquiry, they say, we've gotten rid of it. We've gotten rid of it because we've been able to impose our opinion on everyone. And so, hey, you know, it might as well be facts, right? Because no one's disagreeing. They think that no one disagreeing with an opinion makes it a fact. What is that? That's called magical thinking, magical belief. And of course, it's nothing. Facts aren't made by opinion or belief or vote or coercion. Can't invent facts. Facts are, they're real. They come from reality. Reality is, that's a fact. Prime Creator is, that's a fact. Spirit is, that's a fact. The laws of reality are facts. Why? Because the Prime Creator established them, established reality that way. So, all of that is factual. It's actual. It's not opinions. So, the hard work of inquiry, and it is tough work, has been replaced now by the belief that simply we are going to have opinions imposed upon us, and all disagreement with those opinions is going to be obliterated, and therefore we will have established new facts. This all ties in with the attempt of spirit to be prime creator and create a separate, a new reality, a new creation. In this quote-unquote new creation, the facts will simply be opinions that have no one's disagreeing with the opinions. Because if they do, they get thrown into a mental institution, or quote-unquote re-education center, sorry. And the modalities of treatment there will be very, very modern, high-tech. High-tech treatment for those who engage in inquiry. Only the best, and of course, all for the good, all for the good, right? Because when you wipe out any opposition to opinion stated as fact, then magically, of course, the opinion becomes fact. That's because nobody's opposing it, right? So it's for the greater good. In fact, they say that this new creation will literally take place when all opposition to the central opinions vanish. So of course they have a tremendous stake in this. They believe that they're almost a prime creator, because a prime creator does not become a prime creator unless there's a creation to validate the creator, right? Just like a cause does not become a cause until there's effects, and the effects prove the cause, validate the cause that is there. So those who are trying to be prime creator, they have to have a creation that validates that they're prime creator. And so what they're doing is they want to have a world where everyone agrees on the facts. And they believe that if there's no dissent on opinions here, then that will automatically mean that these are facts. And then these facts will validate the prime creator, that they created these facts. See, amazing, but very easy to see. So that is the goal, the purpose of all this high technology, is to wipe out opposition to a basic agenda. What's decided on is what is just, what is fair, what is righteous, what is good. And those will be seen as facts. By wiping out all opposition, then there's the belief that these are now factual, which means that which gave out these opinions, facts, must be a prime creator, because only a prime creator can create facts. What is real? What is? Amazing. That is literally, we're at the doorstep of that. We're entering into that phase right now. I said after July 5th, everything is in play now. And it is. So, opposition, which is simply inquiry. Inquiry is seen as opposition because inquiry says, I don't know if this is a fact or not. Let me inquire into it. That's seen as opposition. To what? To completing the cycle of creation, cause and effect, right? We wanted to be prime creators, so we've created this fantasy of existence. And we're trying to establish the fact that we're prime creators by establishing facts in existence. Okay? And we're trying to do that by wiping out any inquiry or opposition to these facts, or anyone saying, well, I don't know if that's a fact or not. We're trying to stamp that out so everyone agrees, yes, this is the truth. This is a fact. And that's what I get from young people with certain issues. You just say, what about this? No, this is a fact. You know, they're not stating their opinion. They're stating a fact. They're stating a fact about, you know, any of the hot button issues of the day. They react as though these are facts, that their opinion is a fact. And therefore, they want everybody else to also state as a fact. And once everyone in the world agrees on what the facts are, of agreed upon set of opinions, we say they're all facts, that will complete the creation. And then we'll say, we are prime creators now, because now we have effects that are factual. Like I said, totalitarianism. It's either inquiry or totalitarianism throughout the universe, throughout existence. And when the spirit of inquiry weakens, totalitarianism comes into play. And And so inquiry is in the crosshairs of all this. Because inquiry says, wait a minute, not so fast. I want to get the real facts, right? I want to make sure that I'm getting the real facts. I want to make sure this is not just an opinion. I want to be sure that this is an eternal fact, because anything that's a fact must be eternal, right? It can't change later, because that means it was never a fact in the first place. So, in order to establish facts at all, we have to make sure these facts are arising in eternity. And if existence is temporary, then how can there be any facts in existence? There cannot. Can we really establish facts in existence if existence itself is temporary? Let me tweak this a little bit. The answer is, of course, no. You cannot. You cannot really establish facts if something is temporary, okay? And yet, so those who are trying to establish facts in existence are essentially saying that once we establish facts in existence, that means existence isn't temporary anymore. It's not temporary. So what they're saying is, once we wipe out all opposition to our opinions, we can then plausibly claim that we're dealing with facts, and then we can plausibly claim that existence is eternal. Do you see that? It's still called the logic of plausibility. The logic of plausibility takes you on a wild ride, doesn't it? Again, you have a social issue, an opinion, something, and you want to settle on a conclusion to this and claim that there's a position that's a fact. We're trying to arrive at facts because we're trying to make ourselves prime creator. We know the way, only way to do that is to arrive at facts, because facts must be eternal, right? And so what we're trying to do is we're trying to find some facts in existence. But all we're finding is opinions, different sides, different ways of looking at it. We think, well, if we can just wipe out all opposition, if we can come up with a way to wipe out all opposition to a certain perspective on issues, and we can come up with a little red book of opinions that everyone agrees with, that this is true, I agree 100%, then we can plausibly claim that these are facts, because there's nobody's opposing them. We would say, well, if they're not facts, why is there no one opposing them? Well, because you killed, 50 million people in re-education camps is why nobody's disagreeing. But they never, of course, tell anybody that this took place. Now they say, no, we didn't do away with anybody. Just some malcontents, people who didn't agree with us. And so then they say, okay, nobody's disagreeing, so we can all agree that these are facts, right? And people say, yeah. They say, good, okay, now we got facts. And they say, you know what? Facts have to be eternal, right? And people say, oh yeah, because if it wasn't eternal, it means they'd change. And if they change, it wouldn't be facts. So we say, okay, we've got facts. So what do we also have? We must have eternity. Facts must be arising in eternity. And we say, oh yeah. And then they say, that means existence, where these facts, quote unquote facts, are arising, must be eternal, right? And we say, yeah. Say, that means, since we're the one who are establishing these facts, we must be prime creators, right? And everyone says, yeah, wow, we did it. Unbelievable stuff. And all we had to do is murder millions and millions and millions of people, small price to pay, I guess, to make existence eternal. Yeah, and so the story goes, and so history keeps its story going, you see. I don't want anyone who's engaging in an inquiry to have to be re-educated, right? That's not the purpose of the gurus and the saints and the saviors and the sages. Is to throw us to the wolves, to throw those who are truly have the spirit of inquiry, to throw them to the wolves. That's not the purpose. Which is why I'm saying a big boost is coming. You can see it very clearly now, if you've been able to follow what I'm saying, of how the ego operates through what I call the logic of plausibility. What they do is they establish quote-unquote facts by eliminating opposition to those facts through terror and tyranny, okay, and murder and mayhem and intimidation. Once they've established those quasi-facts through no opposition, they then can make it plausible that that existence is eternal, and since then they can make it plausible that we are prime creators, that spirit is prime creator. That is the entire agenda right there, and it's always in work and at play in existence, and it's at play right now, big time. And again, it is not the purpose of the saviors and the sages and the saints and the gurus and those who are awake to truth. It's not their purpose to allow those who have a spirit of inquiry to be thrown to the wolves just for the sake, so the ego can trumpet that it's discovered that it's prime creator. One day the ego is going to say, hey, I'm prime creator. Because I'm dealing with all this with facts. Everybody's agreeing that these are all facts. We're dwelling in eternal reality, and I'm prime creator of it. The ego will, you know, be able to trumpet that, you know, say, wow. And then the next moment, the ego will say, wait a minute, you know, is there anybody out there who's disagreeing? And they say, well, that one over there has got a frown on their face. Maybe we better get rid of them. And what happens is, step by step by step, even the central bureaucracy, they end up eliminating themselves. Like, I mean, Stalin ended up with everybody dead, in hiding in a prison cell, in some secure prison, having his food slid through a door and having guards taste tested, and, you know, because everybody else was dead. that's the truth. So this, what the ego's doing, it ends up, you know, ego ends up killing everybody. So there's no dissent, making sure there's no dissent. Not even the possibility of dissent. The ego's real goal is for everyone to be dead, actually. So there's no possibility of dissent. So the ego will say, well, there's no dissent. So got that far. Everybody's dead, so there's no dissent. And if there's no dissent, that must mean that there must be some facts. And if there's some facts, it must be this is eternal. And if this is eternal, I must be prime creator. There you go. So, those who realize they're in the crosshairs, those who have this profound spirit of inquiry, who are not willing to accept any opinion as fact, who are willing, who want to dig into it for themselves so they can see it internally. I don't want you to accept what I'm saying as fact, because if you do, it's just an opinion, okay, you can hear it, and you can say, you know, I think there's a lot, intuitively I feel there's a lot of truth to that, but don't accept it as a fact. You have to see it internally. You have to clearly realize it, you know, and you have to keep that spirit of inquiry there, and you have to keep going and keep going. You don't have to become like some a skeptic or hostile or anything like that. No, that's not the point. Don't have to dispute, etc. But the spirit of inquiry needs to be within you. You know, it's not like I'm some central planner who's, you know, dictating facts to you. And if you just say, okay, what are the facts? You're writing them down in a little notebook. You know, okay, he said this, and this. Okay, make sure you study the notebook. And so, you know, when the central planners ask you, you know, what's your opinion? To see, like, your notebook and your notes. Say, this is what I believe. And they say, oh, great. Come on in. You're part of the central planning with us. No, it's not like that. You don't need to take any notes. Don't take notes. Get the spirit of inquiry. That's what you get from teachers like from Krishnamurti. I don't necessarily understand what he's talking about, and it seems a little quaint to me in some ways. But what I get is his heart, his spirit, his integrity, the spirit of inquiry is there. And of course he's using words which are not very clear. But he says, you got to see it. When you see it, it's clarity beyond words. And so what you get from any teacher, helper, advisor, one who's walking along here, is a spirit of inquiry. If you get the spirit of inquiry, then you've got it, you know. You're going to find that facts. If you don't have the spirit of inquiry, if you have the spirit of academia, you're not going to get it. You're not going to find facts. You're simply going to try to find a way to be a 100%er, agreeing with opinions, 100%er. But you won't really, you don't have facts. You don't know facts. You might think you know, but you don't know. See? So don't take any notes. Inquiry doesn't take notes. Inquiry is just quiet. It's still. It's observant. It's just looking for facts. It's not even following linearly necessarily what's being said. It's hearing, listening intuitively. Not selectively, but intuitively. Something clicks, something clicks. You hear something and it clicks. Say, ah. And that directs your attention towards facts. And that's the right spirit. Now, so since I've laid out this, scenario for the future, and I have said that it's not the purpose of those who promoted inquiry throughout the ages, who are the great teachers, like Ramana Maharshi, did he not promote inquiry? What did he do? He just sat there silently, right? He didn't argue with anyone. He just says, inquire into the I. Where did the I come from? What is the I? And he's just very quiet, and people feel that, Ramana is dealing with facts. He knows facts. He's not worried. He's not challenged. He's not interested in disputes. Facts are beyond dispute. So you get that. You get Anandamayima, another one, who simply abided in facts. Was perfectly aware of facts and only facts. She didn't argue. She didn't dispute. She didn't say much at all. She just said the advice she gave is advice how to cultivate inquiry. The spirit of inquiry, saying do a little more every day. You got to more. Keep at it. It's all important. You have teachers like that who have. And Krishnamurti, another one, who convey this intensity of inquiry, the importance of it, to us. And then that gets into us. A Course in Miracles did too. It says, study this. Consider it. So to some extent, theosophy also said, contemplate on this. Consider this. Ponder on this. That's... Dracul's words, ponder on this. Is it true or not? Just ponder on it. Okay, that's inquiry. Now, I don't necessarily agree with all the conclusions of theosophy or any, necessarily, but there was a spirit of inquiry there, which is very helpful. Ponder on this. Don't accept that I'm saying it's true or not. Find your own truth. You must find the facts for yourself. There's no higher religion than truth. I think that's the motto of theosophy. No higher religion than truth, which is a fact. There's no higher facts than facts. There's another way of putting it. No higher facts than facts. There's no facts that contravene facts. God does not contradict itself, Prime Creator does not contradict itself, no. Reality is not in conflict with itself. Existence thinks that existence is in conflict with reality, and that existence is going to win this conflict when everybody agrees that this is a fact, and all opposition is wiped out. Of course, how do you wipe it out? Do you wipe it out through facts or through other methodologies? And if you're not wiping it out through facts, what are the other methodologies? And how successful can they become? And since they're not successful, don't they become more and more harsh? Just look at all the methodologies in history that have been used to try to coerce and intimidate people into agreeing on that existence is defeating reality, has defeated reality. As if we all agree that existence has defeated reality, that this will be a fact. Just because we all agree on it. How do we all agree on it? Getting rid of those who don't agree, you see. pretty silly, huh? Very, very silly stuff. So it's not our purpose to remain in the clutches of silliness. Of juvenile silliness, juvenile zeal, you know. Juvenile zeal, they think, oh my gosh, I see the way to free us all, and we can all, existence will be eternal, we'll be prime creators, we see it. You know, that's juvenile attitude. They there's a point, they say, oh my gosh, I think I know the way to do it, you know. We'll just, they don't listen to anyone says you can't do that, and they don't, and they have the energy and the zeal to do it. Totalitarian comes from juvenile-minded people who have a lot of energy, a lot of zeal. So it's usually revolutions come from younger people who have not yet developed the perspective, have not either engaged in inquiry or have not gone deep enough in inquiry, and who have latched on to the nearest, the newest power trip, whatever it is, and have realize, hey, we can use this to gain compliance. Everyone can be in compliance. And then they use the energy and the zeal to go for that. But and oftentimes it's the elder people who are in the crosshairs. Those who are, you know, not so sure of themselves, not in compliance, complete compliance, are potentially not in compliance. You see, even if you're in compliance, it goes to the point where they say, well, you might not be in compliance in the future, so, you know, we better deal with that problem. So everybody eventually becomes a problem to the zealous attempt to establish facts in existence, establish the fact that existence has triumphed over reality. Therefore, existence is eternal, and therefore we're prime creators. Yeah, of course it's almost humorous. It's so silly, but it's not so humorous when you're in the crosshairs, you know. But we don't have to be. What I have seen, is we don't have to be. Our prayers and our intentions should be in that direction. We don't have to be. We don't have to be stuck in the crosshairs of this. Krishnamurti wasn't asking us to be fools. You know, when he was warning, he didn't want us to be fools for this. And maybe we'll jump into some further issues up ahead. I don't want to overload this video with too much, because we've already touched on an amazing amount of information that, you know, shocking information here. And of course you can say, well, it's not a fact. All right, of course not a fact. It is a likelihood, though. You can't talk about anything in existence as a fact, because nothing in existence is all impermanent, right? But in the play of impermanence is a very strong likelihood that this is what we're headed towards. Excuse me. You see, the polarization will become so extreme. The gridlock will be so extreme. The economic situation will collapse so severely that there will be this enormous zeal to get everyone on the same page. And litmus tests will be set up. It's always the same thing. It's the same old, same old. That happened in communist China, Soviet Union, those places. And the very same mindset that brought that all about is now in the United States and around the world is bringing it about. Very same mindset. That is, you know, very evident. And there are litmus tests. You know, that what they do is they make it very easy to cull out those who either are not on the same page or at some point might not be on the same page. So they're looking for 100%ers. You know, they're not looking for people to say, yes, sir. They're looking for people to say, yes, sir. You know, and to say, yes, yes, sir, 1,000 times a day. Or in this case, it might be, yes, ma'am. Right? Yeah. That's so we didn't see it coming. You know, be looking for the yes, sir, yes, sir. Who am I saying yes, sir, to? Yes, sir, yes, sir, to. And all along, it's yes, ma'am. We had nice disguise for it. The spirit of inquiry, it deals in facts. And this whole universe is just a projection. It's impermanent. Therefore, there's no facts. The universe is not a fact. It's impermanent. Facts are permanent. The universe is a whim. It's a hypothetical scenario. Hypothetical scenarios are not facts. So everything in the universe also is just a hypothetical scenario. What we are is the dreamer is not in the dream, okay? They might symbolize themselves in the dream, like we fall asleep and we see ourselves in the dream and doing stuff, but we are not in the dream, at least for this analogy, the body lying there is not actually, you know, running down a street, you know, jumping in a boat and doing all the stuff in the dream. No, this is lying in a bed. So the dreamer is not really in the dream. They're symbolized as being in the dream. So we're dreaming a dream of a universe, but we're not in the universe. We're in it, but not of it, so to speak. That's another way of putting it, but we're really not even in it at all. We're dreaming it. So the fact the universe is impermanent doesn't mean that we are impermanent. Same way that when a dream ends, the dreamer doesn't end. The dream was impermanent, but not the dreamer. So the universe is impermanent, but not the dreamer of the universe. And not the presenter of it. Not that which chose this idea, and not that which presents the idea, which is mind. We call mind as the presenter of ideas. It's permanent, and just because what it presents doesn't last doesn't mean it's not permanent, because it was a dream of impermanence, so to speak. Reality is permanent. It was a dream of denial, a dream of forgetfulness. And forgetfulness of reality cannot be permanent, can it? Because if it was permanent, it would be the reality. How can forgetfulness of reality be the reality? Well, we're trying to make it the reality. And you got some very clever juveniles, very zealous and clever juveniles in control of the means to try and accomplish this. And they certainly will try to accomplish it. A strong likelihood of that. And seeing this, you know, being wide-eyed to this, you know, it would be foolish to merely acquiesce to this, go along with it, you know, serves no purpose except just ridiculous delay. So I say sidestep it, you know, somehow sidestep it. And any increased awareness helps sidestep it, because you see what it is you're sidestepping. You see, and the claim of those that if you sidestep it, you're going to be annihilated is because they believe that they're establishing a new reality by everyone agreeing of what the quote-unquote facts are, meaning that existence is eternal, meaning we're the creators, new prime creators. And if we're not part of that, they claim, well, you're going to miss out on new reality and you will be annihilated. You see how that logic of plausibility deals with those who want to sidestep the situation. They'll claim, oh, it's terrible. I mean, you're missing out on this. Horrible. You're going to be annihilated. What you're part of, the old reality is completely gone, defeated. As soon as we establish this new one, the old one is annihilated. So that's what they tell us. And they think they're doing us a service by warning us of our folly, you know, and sidestepping it. I don't know if who can follow this, but it's just a continuation of logical plausibility. Has to be, right? I mean, if this is a new reality, how can anyone be going to some other reality? It's not possible. In other words, they'll say, this is it. Right here, this is it. There is no other it. If you're not here, you're nowhere. That's, you know, be here or be square. They used to say, be here or be nowhere. If you're not here, you're nowhere. If you're not in the yellow pages, you don't exist. If you're not here, part of this collective exercise in a magically establishing fact, then you are nowhere. You don't exist. That's their belief. They have to believe that. Otherwise, they'd say, well, they can't believe that, well, these people, they left and went somewhere else and they returned to reality. They can't believe that. They say, whoa, wait a minute, no. We're establishing reality. We're the ones who are establishing reality. They can't go to some other reality. It's not possible. So then they say, well, they must have met some terrible end, you know. Something terrible. If whatever it is, it's got to be something terrible. So, you know, so that those who are trying to establish this new reality are repulsed by the very notion. They can't even think about, oh, something awful must have happened to them. Just terrible. Now, let's not even think about it anymore. You know, what a shame. What a shame. Yeah. They have to think that way. Have to. In order to be in compliance with the goal of existence, to plausibly establish a chain of plausibility that rests on the premise of forced, coerced consensus, agreement, 100% agreement, through coercion, through force, through any and all means. And if you really study history, the means, any and all means that have been used have just been a litany of heinous, you know, tactics, just truly terrible. And all the new techniques, etc., they also have their own terrible, terrible aspects to them. Happy day, you know. Well, it's a happy day just to be able to explain this to you. Hopefully this video will stay up for a while. Because who knows when the compliance, the iron fist of compliance will start. Maybe it's a velvet glove, actually. Velvet glove of compliance will start, you know, hammering everyone down, hammering the nails down. And hopefully we will be somewhere else by then, and shifting into multidimensionality, okay, and or stepping out of harm's way in some fashion. I don't want to dig into that. I don't feel like digging into that right now. That'll come in its own good time. It'll come. But this video itself, the tight focus here has been remarkable. And spilling the beans, you know, spilling the beans. You're not going to hear this very many other places. Spilling the beans without being mean about it, you know, without naming names and companies and, you know, being that way about it. No, I mean, because they will have to see the error of their ways at some point. We don't want to get entangled in all this, you know, detail. Is the big picture is important. You know, who, what, where, it's not that important. Really doesn't matter. If it's not one, it's another. You know, that's how existence works. And trying to bring this out in the open has been a lifelong effort for me. And so I'm very happy to actually be able to do this finally and say what needs to be said. And I hope the gurus and the sages and the saviors, etc., are delighted as well, you know, that it's being said here. What's going on is being said in a nice way, in a kind way, in a loving way. But still, we're not dodging facts. We're not sugarcoating anything here. And there's a way to do it without being, you know, combative here, with some humor, with a smile. And I hope that's being conveyed, because that's how I feel. You know, it's... And we have to remain in that, you know. Don't get into a hostile mode, because that's not inquiry. Inquiry, again, doesn't react emotionally so much at all. It just says, oh, no. Facts don't need emotion to support them, okay? Facts support themselves. Facts are facts. Love is a fact. Unconditional love is a fact. It just is. It's unchanging. Present. Always present. Omnipresent. Not increasing, not decreasing, not judging one way or the other. Overlaying everything equally. Equally available to all. Every moment. Everything's pre-qualified to experience it, to step into it, and to experience it eternally, endlessly. That's a fact. And so facts are not unstable. They're not combative. They don't need to be combative. Why? They're not threatened by lies. They're not threatened by a chain of plausibility. If you see the chain of plausibility, it's pretty amusing, right? How kind of like you see a cat. You have a cat, and you know the tricks the cat has. Cats have all sorts of kind of little tricks, but we can see and we know what the cat's up to. I always tell my cat, you know, I say, I know what you're up to. I know what you're up to. I know your tricks. The cat just looks at me and says, "Ah, you sure you know? I don't know. Maybe this time I'm gonna get you." I say, "No. I know your tricks. You're just waiting, you know, for me to leave so you can get up on this seat, you know." The cat says, "No. I'm just hanging out here." I say, "Yeah, sure, but as soon as I leave, you're gonna be up here, right?" The cat just kind of, you know. Not admitting to it, you know, the cats never admit that you can see their tricks, but it's amusing because you can see them, you know. And same thing with plausibility here, looking at this whole thing, it's pretty amusing because plausibility thinks, you know, hey, nobody can see this, you know, this is like really smart, really clever, huh? We'll coerce everybody into agreeing on a set agenda, and then we'll call that consensus and agreement, we'll call that a fact, and then that'll establish that the fact, well, if it's a fact, it must be eternal, and if it's eternal, existence must be eternal, and if existence is eternal, and we're the ones who are projecting existence, then we must be prime creators of eternity and facts, and so we are the prime creators. Well, very clever, you know, very clever, you know, very sly, very tricky, you know, and plausibility is hoping, no, nobody can see this, right? No, nobody can see this. And when you see it, you know, it's so obvious, you know, it's like, wow, it's pretty funny, really. Pretty, get a chuckle out of it. You know, it's kind of like a kid saying, oh my gosh, I can rule the world. I just figured out how to rule the world, you know. Just got everybody to agree with me. And of course, we used to laugh at that and say, well, you know, that's how silly, you know, it's impossible. But now, with all the digital technology, the internet, et cetera, it's not so impossible to impose draconian consensus on the world. It's very easy to stampede the world right now. And there will be ways and means to do it. There'll be issues that'll be used to do that. Stampede the world and, you know, they say, hey, if you're not with us, you're against us. You're not for us, you're against us. If you're not 100%er, you're a 0%er. Say, we're here to establish facts. We want facts. Fact. And we say, well, that's an opinion. No, it's a fact. You know, they'll say. And why is it a fact? Because we say it's a fact and you can't say otherwise. And then we say, well, what if we do say otherwise? Well, you'll just need to be re-educated then. And oh, really? Why? Well, you just don't have any more access to banking and the internet and doing business and all this kind of stuff. So until you, but you can change that if you just accept this as fact. You say, well, I don't really see it as a fact. And then they say, well, we have ways and means of helping you see it that way. And I say, well, guess what? Not really interested in that either. And there you go. And you say, you know what? I see a better destiny. I want to go where there's real facts. You know why I know they're real facts? Because I didn't establish them. That's why. I didn't do anything to establish them. I didn't coerce anything. I didn't intimidate. Didn't kill anything. I go to a place where everything's invulnerable, so how could I be coercing anything? And go to a place where I didn't establish any facts. Facts were established by the Prime Creator. You see, in existence, we keep thinking we can establish facts, our own facts. Therefore, if we do, we must be Prime Creator, right? Because it's the Prime Creator that establishes facts. But let's go somewhere where we're perfectly peaceful and loving and not harming anything. And then we know nothing's being coerced. Go to a place where nothing can be coerced because everything is invulnerable. Okay? And then you will know that you're experiencing real facts because there's nothing that came about through any coercion. You're not in some kind of groupthink consensus place where everybody's thinking the same, so they're thinking, well, what we're agreeing upon must be a fact because we all agree upon it. No, the facts should be self-evident, not something we established, and no possibility of any coercion because no fear. Complete carefree place, a place that carefree, no concern, no fear. You see, in existence, the ego's always terrified that someone might just have second thoughts about some agreement they made, right? That's why the ego lops off everybody's head eventually. Because the ego gets paranoid, say, you know, that person might disagree, might backtrack on their agreement, and so that'll disestablish the facts, and that'll disestablish me as Prime Creator. So we gotta off with their head. Now, first comes re-education, and then later comes off with their heads, you know, because as the paranoia grows, once the ego thinks it's on the throne of as Prime Creator, then it says, well, how do I keep this? You know, I gotta keep this. And then it says, well, I gotta make sure no one disagrees. And then he starts looking for signs of disagreement. And they start saying, that person, I didn't like the look in their eyes. I felt uncomfortable with the look in their eyes. Made me feel uncomfortable. You know, I was offended. I was offended by the way they looked at me. I didn't like that. Off with their heads, you know, because I think they might disagree with me. So back to the beginning of the video, this whole culture of education that are educating everybody to be offended and what to do about being offended and to feel uncomfortable. Like I say, oh, I felt uncomfortable because I didn't like the way that they were looking at me, or I didn't like the expression, or I walked past them and they laughed, and they might have been laughing at me. It made me feel very uncomfortable. I didn't feel safe, and I feel offended by that, and I really shouldn't have to put up with that at all. I shouldn't be offended. I shouldn't have to feel uncomfortable at all. So I need to do that. That person needs to be dealt with by the authorities. That is the education that is being given. I have spoken to some young people, and they have told me straight out, because they trusted me. You know, I wasn't gonna finger them or anything. I wasn't gonna rat on them. I'm just saying in general sense. They told me flat out, this is what's happening, and they live in terror. They live in terror in their schools, because they realize that they're being targeted. And they're being practiced on, you know, as, oh, you're making me feel uncomfortable. I feel uncomfortable, you know. So that's the ego is practicing all of this and getting an entire generation or two in alignment with this. And the older generations wants to just kind of go along with it. The ego realizes that we're not so easily offended, you know. and not so easily made to feel uncomfortable. Or, you know, if we are, you know, tough it out. You know, you don't go running to the authorities for any reason. You know, that's how I was raised. You don't bring the authorities into any situation unless it is truly drastic. You know, you deal with situations person to person. Spirit of Christ, spirit of love, spirit of reconciliation, spirit of forgiveness. And you deal with all situations that way. You do not go running for mommy, you know. You do not go running for the authority and say, I don't like that person. They made a joke about me or something, and you need to, like, you know, crush them. No. Say, well, you know, you made a joke about me. Whatever. You know. And then, you know, there's kind of this mutual respect, you know. And you never rat out a person. Okay? Even here, while I'm telling you about this totalitarianism that's going to come, I'm not going to rat out those who are doing it, really. Don't want to. Because, you know, ultimately, we have to deal with it, right? We have to deal with it. We're not going to go running to some authority. Well, you go running to God's grace, but that's true authority. You know, it's not a punishing authority. It's a saving authority. So, you know, the way that the younger generation is very, very, almost inconceivable for older generation, because we treated each other, we understood there's differences. We understood we won't see eye to eye. We understood that sometimes we'll get offended, sometimes we'll feel uncomfortable. We understood that's all part of being here. And that's what we have to put up with. And if we get into the spirit of inquiry, you know, it makes it easier to put up with it. And we realize we're all brothers and sisters in Christ, meaning in truth, in reality, in multidimensionality. And we know that eventually we'll all recognize our oneness. So let's be very kind, and let's not come to blows. Let's not go running to the authorities. Let's not file complaints. You don't file complaints. I have had all sorts of stuff that's happened to me and been involved with all, you know, terrible stuff, and never filed a complaint. I never told anybody, really. You know, it's my responsibility. Whatever, you know, happens to me, takes two to tango. You know, that's a fact. You know, we weren't taught victimization. What is being taught in throughout the world in educational systems is victimization. How to be a victim. And what people are being taught is that everybody's a victim. Or a potential victim. And they're being taught how to respond to this quote-unquote victimization. Okay? It's all totalitarianism. It's Nazism. It's communism. That's exactly the way it's done. And, you know, they're taught to be easily offended, to look for offense, to feel victimized, to claim victim status, and then go to the authorities and say, you know, I was victimized, that one victimized me. You know, to a hammer, everything looks like a nail. To someone who has developed victim consciousness, you know, everyone looks like a perpetrator of victimization. Every day they can find some way to be victimized. And as the laws and the rules keep changing to encourage victimization, you know, the next latest one is bullying, you know. Okay, somebody is bullied, all right. Well, there are ways to deal with it. And usually, you know, in the past, adults would step in, okay. And people respected their elders. Adult would just step in and say, hey, you know, knock it off. And the young people would, you know, okay, you know, if I don't knock it off, you know, I'm going to get paddled. You know, we've done away with all corporal punishment, right? Any parent does that, they'll go to jail. You know, the young people, the juvenile mindset, the young people have all these laws now, which have protect them from any adult stepping in and saying, knock it off. I had some kids a while ago, young kids, like they were maybe 10 or something, they were taunting me, you know, making funny sounds, trying to just taunt me, you know. And I said, I realize, you know, if I say anything to them, they're going to go run to their dad and say, this guy is scaring us or something. How dare he say anything to us, you know? And I could get in trouble if I just say, hey, kids, you know, shut up. What's the matter with you? Grow up, you know, stop being so immature. You know, or just, you say, knock it off. It used to be, of course, adults would say, they'd knock it off, and the kids would respect it because they know that they can't get away with everything. But now, the kids believe they can get away with anything. Parents cannot lift a finger against them at all. They cannot discipline them at all. So they feel perfectly safe to taunt elder people, to bully them like crazy, you see? And nobody does anything about it. They're too frightened to do it. Total totalitarian setup. Trap, 100%. These kids have been raised on this belief. And they see it. Adults are terrified of them. And they think, hey, Mike, you know, we can get away with anything. We can do anything. As soon as you get in that mindset, then they start, you know, looking at ways and means of, you know, hey, we can be all powerful here. You know, with no checks on us, no balances. We can claim victim status in any way. If anyone tries to stop us, we'll just say, hey, they're victimizing us. Hey, they're making us feel uncomfortable. And off they go. You know, social services come in, or off they go to re-education, or off they go just like that. And this happened in history over and over again. This is exactly what takes place. Once the mechanisms get in place, it's what takes place. You get a knock in the night. Come for the parents. I mean, all the children have to do is they say, hey, the parents insulted our great leader. They only have to file a claim to the local official. In the nighttime, the officials come. Whoosh, parents are gone. Never see them again. You know, happens over and over in history. What happens is that the young people make these claims like, hey, you know, my parents, they didn't let me attend this, you know, rally for the great leader. Parents disappear. Hey, my parents didn't give me their full inheritance so I can give it to the great leader. Parents disappear. So we are, you know, like in quicksand right now. And the quicksand is like up to our necks. We're dealing with that right now. And there's really no turning back because of the way that the laws and everything have been formulated right now. It's really an unstoppable express. Let's see if we can... Whoops, let me... Express this. That's not it. Is this it? There you go. We're up to our necks in quicksand. Okay, we're almost ready to drown in these dynamics. You know, pretty soon, you know, we'll get like this. Oh, we're going under, you know. Gone. All right, but we need to keep our heads above water, right? And that's what this satsang is doing. We need to like be like a cork kind of popping here, keeping our heads above water so we can breathe. And I think everyone who's listening to this kind of knows what's being talked about here. They may not agree on the severity of it or the outcome of it at all, but you know, where there's smoke, there's fire, right? Generally speaking, when there's a lot of smoke, dark smoke, there's fire. Historically speaking, when all these different situations have arisen and the youth have been propagandized into victimization and how to attack those who feel they're victimized, how to turn them over to the authorities is essentially what it is, then it always comes about that these situations end up getting real bad, and we end up getting, you know, pulled down like this. And right now we're kind of here and we're trying to keep looking at it, you know. But what we really need to do is somehow, through the grace of God and reality and truth and facts, we need to be able to get free of it. How long is this one? About 2 hours. Well, you know, what can I say? It's time well spent. Anyone who's watched this video has gotten a full dose of real politics here, of what's really going on. Yeah, I felt it. It's amazing. Those kids really pointed out to me. They were mocking me, taunting, mocking. You know, I could tell they had this bully mentality of seeing how they can disrespect their elders, you know. I just said, hey, you know, I kind of ignored them. But I also realized if I said anything, I was the one who was going to get in trouble. You know, the kids are blameless. They can't be disciplined any way. So basically, as an adult, you really can't say anything. I didn't say anything. I just ignored them. Just ignored him, went on with my business. I wasn't upset by them so much as the fact that you can't say anything anymore. See? That should be a red flag, right? A severe warning sign. Because when someone, you know, you're in a situation and someone just says, hey, you know what, you're making me feel uncomfortable. I say, why? I don't know, it's just your attitude or something, you know, I just don't feel comfortable around it, you know? And, you say, well, you know, so what? I'm not trying to do that. And they say, well, you know, you make me feel uncomfortable, and I'm going to, you know, alert the authorities that you insulted me. You said something that's, you engaged in some hate speech. You know, you engaged in hate speech. Or I feel that you are a hateful person. That you're intolerant, that you're a bigot, that you're a racist, you're a sexist, you're this or this, that. Or I get the feeling that you're that way, and I'm feeling uncomfortable. And if they need to, they'll conjure up some fake crime or something that you, you know, whatever. They'll just make accusations that are baseless. Just make them up. But in the situation we're in now, There'll be so many accusations flying that you know, and the way that the DAs and the prosecutors and the whole legal system is and everything, the mood of the country. Like I say, well, you know, re-education, you know, this one is a prime candidate for re-education. We'll do a little evaluation, say, oh, you know, you don't pass our litmus tests, re-educate. And so there'll be this culling process. People will be culled out of society very quickly. That's what happens in the past examples. China, Russia, people are culled. They're brought in for questioning, and they say, well, you know what? You know, your attitude is definitely something that lends itself to re-education. Hey, just your demographic does, you know, just your age, just your, you know. And of course, they're keeping data on everybody on these on the internet, and they will have access to all the sites that you visited, okay? There's a reason why there's data kept on all of you. Because very soon, when you are brought to these centers and they're going to question you, say, hey, someone made a complaint about you, and they said you made this bigoted statement, or you made this statement that was a political statement that wasn't right, or you're on the wrong side of this issue, and we want to just kind of ask you about it. And, you know, and you say, well, nah, you know, I didn't say that, or I don't feel that way, or misinterpreted wrong context, or just inquiring into the issue or something. They say, well, we pulled up your internet data. It's very interesting, the sites that you have visited. You see, you've visited all these various sites, and you know what? The people there are expressing these very anti-bigoted, terrible viewpoints, you know. And so, you know, why did you visit all those sites? You know, and you say, well, I was just inquiring into both sides of the issue, you know, and just seeing what different perspectives are. And they will say, well, you know what? You know, these issues have been settled. Okay, they're settled issues. They're not in dispute any longer. So the very fact that you were visiting all these sites means that you don't accept the fact that these issues have been settled. Therefore, you need to be re-educated. You need to accept the fact that they're been settled, okay, for all time, eternally. These are facts. You need to be re-educated in the facts, and then off you go to a re-education camp. And good luck with that. Gee, you know, they ran out of food, you know. Oh, what a pity. We don't really have much food for you, you know, these days, but that may help your re-education. And those who do accept the facts, guess what? They get more food. They get the food. How about that? Very clever, those people, huh? Like it's never been done before. Like, hey, we came up with some really clever stuff here. Yeah, let's just have food shortage and use that to help re-educate people. Yeah, that's really very effective, right? Yeah. It's not propaganda, no. It's not coercion, no. No, human rights aren't being violated because we're just helping them see the facts. Wow, very clever of them, huh? What geniuses to figure that out. Yeah, no, what juveniles to think that they're coming up with something, you know, that's never been done before in the history of mankind. We're getting to facts finally. We found a way to arrive at facts and to establish the reality of existence and to establish the fact we're prime creators. We finally figured it out. Just starve them. Yeah, wow. Very ingenious. Very inventive. And those who refuse to accept the facts, well, just naturally, how can they continue to live in reality? They're culling themselves out, right? That's the rationale. So there's no mercy or pity or feeling of conscience on these people at all. The Soviets, they didn't look at all the people they killed in the gulags and they didn't, you know, they didn't feel bad about it. They said, no, these people culled themselves, they killed themselves. They showed themselves their incapacity to accept the facts that brought about their death, you see. So they didn't kill anybody. That's what they believe. No. Now these are the lessons of history, you know. If you don't learn them, you're doomed to repeat them. Just now, this whole thing, though, has been sneaking up on us because we were dazzled by, you know, hey, look at this nice new gadget we have here. Dun, da, 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 da. You know, up on stage, showing this really, look at this, look how nice it is, you know. Wow. Get all this music and all these movies and stuff. Wow, we're really tremendous. And then, of course, like I said before, you know, we're all looking, who are the bad guys, who are the bad guys, who are the bad guys, you know. Yeah, but we're not thinking, you know, who are the bad girls, you know, not at all, not at all, we're not looking in that direction at all. So it all sneaks up on us, it all sneaks up on us, you know, the culture of victimization. Oh, I feel so uncomfortable. I'm so victimized. I once overheard a conversation. I won't say who or where. I was reading a book and someone else was behind me and they started talking about their career path and their purpose in life. And I don't know if they were on alcohol or why they were talking so openly and freely. I think they were just so like juvenile saying, you know, they said, yay. I know a way I'm going to save the world, you know, and what they literally said is they're going to learn how to pretend to be victimized by all their bosses and throw lawsuits against their bosses. They're going to make up, they said, I'm just going to make up victimization. I'm going to sue my bosses. I'm going to make a ton of money that way. And she said, this is my goal and path in life. She was entirely serious about it. I have no doubt that she did just what she was saying. She had it all worked out perfectly. She had this plan of this is what I'm going to do in life. I'm going to pretend to be a victim of everyone. And I'm just going to sue them and intimidate them and get everything that I want. And so you have all generations of those who have developed a system where they can sue anybody. You know, very easily sue people by concocting, you know, situations. He said, she said situations, etc. And lots of other things. And terrorize and intimidate all businesses, you know, by bad publicity and lawsuits, etc. You know, professional victims. We have generations of professional victims. The profession is victimization. And so they can finger anybody. They can bring down anybody. They can merely say, you know, this person did this, and who are you going to believe? And the people will say, well, we believe you. And anyway, look at all these websites they visited. They're not really a good person anyway, so off you go. So, you know, in being aware of all this stuff, you start to put two and two together, and you see it. You see the picture, and one day you say, oh my gosh, it's really happening. It's really here. It's really here. And just think of all the data that's stored on you. The government, through what echelon or something. Who does that? No, it's not echelon. It's some firm that has been keeping track of all emails, all data, everything. I have no doubt your emails have been kept track of also by the government. And then you have these private, huge corporations keeping track of everything you do on the internet. Government and these big internet corporations are all part of one plan, one scheme. Okay? They'll share all the information. They'll work together on all of this. It's all been planned. And so they'll have all this data on you, you know? They may not even wait for complaints. They may just have these algorithms that just flag you for the various websites you visited. I was visiting websites yesterday, just looking into something in the spirit of inquiry. I want to say, I wonder some various opinions about the recent Supreme Court decision. Let me go here. And then I visited some websites, and I said, you know what? I could really get in trouble from just visiting this website, because I'm sure that, you know, I'm logged into, you know, the internet, and I'm sure it's, you know, being kept as history, and the data is being collected. And at some point, you know, someone say, on this date you visited this, oh, that's, you're really bad for doing that. You know, revisionism, right? Revisionism, the spirit of revisionism is very strong, which means to pass laws now that criminalize previous behavior, which was not criminal at the time. That is what is happening. That is the trend of these juveniles, is to say, well, what you did in the past was legal at the time, but it should have been criminal. But it's criminal now, therefore, we're going to try you under these new statutes now for what you did in the past. And we say, what about the statute of limitations? Say, well, it doesn't apply anymore, because these are crimes against humanity, because they're ideational crimes. In other words, you're not agreeing with our position, which is now a de facto crime against humanity. Okay? Therefore, you're being tried on no statute of limitations, retroactive laws. Retroactive laws. Revisionism is to say what was done in the past was really an atrocity in the past, and overlooking the context of the times and using present-day standards to judge the past. It's called revisionism, a certain way. Also, revisionism can be just to change the past, you know, and say these things didn't happen. But another way of looking at it is to say that the behavior in the past, to judge past behavior with present-day standards. And the next step is to apply present-day laws to past behavior by wiping out statute of limitations, etc. And I know for a fact that behavior in the past, the context of the times, it was completely different than what people are looking at it now in the present. Those who are saying, yeah, that should be seen as a criminal action in the past. The times are very, very different. You know, if you haven't lived through those times, you can't really judge it at all. You don't really know. Very difficult to know. Certainly superficially. So I'm very, very slow to judge people on what they did in the past, really. Because there's all sorts of different social contracts in place at that time, which said, yeah, this is okay for various reasons, etc., etc. And then nowadays, the social contract has been changed so much that under the new social contracts, we would say, oh my gosh, this is a horrible crime under these new social contracts. And in our desire to be righteous, we think, well, these new social contracts are right, and the old ones are wrong. So we can't excuse this behavior just based on a wrong social contract in the past. And people need to be judged on this new right factual social contract, as if the social contract we have today is somehow fact, is right. Now, social contracts are very different in the past, believe me. The way that genders treat each other is very different. Talk to older people, you know, and you interact, different genders interacting, and you realize, oh, they, you know, they had a feeling of self-responsibility. They didn't have a feeling of victimization. It wasn't there. You know, nowadays, you know, there's just this massive feeling of victimization. I mean, look in the past and say, oh my gosh, look at all the victims. Everybody was a victim. Not true. Not true at all. It's just, it's a way of looking at it. So you're gonna have that retroactive, you know, laws applied retroactively like that. So you have this whole gamut of stuff. People, you know, I've said that everyone's under blackmail, which is true, because I became aware that in the past years, that the interaction I was having with some certain people, they were intentionally setting me up by interacting with me in a certain way, that later on in later years they'd be able to bring this up and say, ah, that interaction, we had this interaction up there, and it would be criminalized in the future. They knew they would criminalize it in the future, so to speak. Something very innocuous that they themselves set up in order to blackmail me into silence. I was very aware of that. That's what they're doing. And so I went along with that stuff. I'd go along with it. I'd say, huh, I want to see what you're up to. You're up to some very strange stuff here. Why do you want me to do this? That's my feeling. I said, huh, they want me to do this. I said, why do you want to do that? And they're really insistent. Yeah, this is great. This is what I want. I said, okay, you know, whatever. If that's what you want. And then I said, huh, there's something very strange about them. And then I gradually began to realize that then they're filing this away in their victimization cabinet, so to speak, files. And then in, you know, 10, 15 years, 20 years down the line, they're going to say, aha, I want to press charges or something, right? I want to blackmail this person. That's blackmail. Because they knew in the future it's going to be criminalized. And they want to set up ahead of time this action. See, so I went along with it because I was inquiring into what's going on, you see. I said, I want to inquire into what's going on here. So what is your game? You know, what's the game you're playing here? Because I was kind of like, so this is kind of weird, you know. Something isn't right here. I smell a rat. You know, and I have said that most of everyone is being blackmailed now by those who have collected some sort of victimization, something they can define as in the future as victimization. And they're being frightened, blackmailed into silence, blackmailed into going along with the agenda. You see, that's why very few people are speaking out. The agenda is very easy to see, but we're terrified that we're going to be blackmailed. Definitely terrified of it. Because almost everyone probably, if they dig through it, it's amazing how clever these people were, you know, really. I saw myself, they were setting me up, like staging the whole thing. And I just kind of sat there and said, okay, what's going on? And they made it look like I'm some kind of bad guy or something, or doing something, and staged it, you know, and then even collected evidence on it, photo, video, photograph, whatever. And then something they could present in down the road to make it look like, you know, they were victimized or something. It really is at that level of cleverness. So these people are very clever who are engaged in all this activity. The ego is very clever. But it's not clever enough. It's not clever enough to get past the Holy Spirit, God's grace. So God's grace told me, just look at this. Go along with it. See what's happening. Don't panic. Don't get in an argument. Just observe. Just observe. So I just observed. I just observed, you know, what's going on. I said, ah, wow. These people mean business, huh? They're collecting dossiers on everybody to retroactively prosecute them. Interesting stuff. That's what the guys in high school told me. They said, my gosh, you know, no matter what we do, we feel that we're offending somebody, and we're in trouble. And I mean, just normal behavior, like especially for young people. Young people are all over the place, you know. It's easy to come up with something, you know, that to charge them at some point in time with some kind of, you know, criminal action or victimization action, or some. They said, oh, I remember they said something in class. They were laughing and talking with their friends, and I overheard them use some slur or something. Boom, there you go. There's the victimization thing, you know. What young people are doing is they're observing, they're digging, they're looking, they're thinking, they're considering, you know, what's going on in this world? Why do people think this? And why are these opinions this way or that way? You know, I think young people naturally kind of inquire. They're inquiring. What's really true here? What's going on? So of course they're going to do stuff and say things, etc., that reflect this uncertainty. Okay? So what? And yet, there's this, from early school now, everyone is being taught, keep all victimization in your mind. Make a note of it. And probably even been taught to write it down. Keep a diary, you know. Keep a diary of anything you overhear, any victimization. It's kind of like a class project, you know, the way they're presenting it now is look for victimization in society and look for examples where you've been victimized as well. And look for bigotry in society and try and come up with catch some bigotry in your own life, you know. Did your parents say something that might be bigoted? Look for racism in society. Look for sexism in society. Look for examples. And did your parents or your friends, did you overhear anything that might have been racist or bigoted, sexist, or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, impolitic, not politically correct? Make a diary of this stuff so you become more aware of it. That's your responsibility as a responsible citizen. You're supposed to be doing this. So, in other words, they tell the kids that this is what, how you raise, you become a responsible citizen, is if you root out the intolerance or the bigotry, or whatever, in the world. You root it out. You go seeking for it and find it and then root it out and make a note of it. And then later on in the diary, they say, I got a note in my diary here. You know, 1998, you know, I remember I had this interaction. Someone said something, you know, blah, 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 blah. And I know who it was. It's right here in the diary. And they present the diary to the office of culling, the culling out office. And they say, well, here's the evidence. We got evidence, you know. They got it in the diary right here, and we believe them. We don't believe you because look at the websites you visit or whatever. We've got all this other information on you. The overall body of evidence, if we weigh it, says that you're a good candidate for re-education. There you go. That's literally what's been happening. I became aware of that. People are keeping diaries, and they're actually making up stuff as well, okay? They're inventing stuff and then claiming that because it's in a diary, it must be true. And they know that they present it to the prosecutors. The prosecutors will say, well, you know, it's a diary. I could be making up stuff in a diary. This is evidence. It will be accepted as evidence. I became aware, intuitively aware, there are a lot of people who are writing fantasy in their diary, something that didn't even happen. Let's say they don't like somebody. They say, oh, I overheard that person saying this and this and this today. And they write in their diary. And then they can use it as evidence later, or as blackmail, etc. That's also happening, that diaries will be accepted as evidence, okay? And of course, if you don't like somebody, you can write anything you want to in a diary. You can say they did this to you, they victimized you, they did this and that. Just invent it. They're being encouraged, people are being encouraged to do that. Maybe not directly, but they said in order to become a good citizen, you have to be able to get rid of the bad citizens. See, and you have to be able to identify them. And if you identify a bad citizen, it's okay to, read stuff into their actions, you know. And in the past, people have been encouraged to, they say it's okay to lie about a bad citizen. You know, it's not a crime. It's not a crime to make stuff up about a bad person, because if they're a bad person, they deserve to be called out anyway. So you're, you know, making up something, that's okay. Don't worry about it. That's what's happened, right? I mean, in the trials of the Soviet Union and China, do you think the evidence presented was factual? No, people simply made stuff up. They said, I heard this person cursing the supreme leadership and saying how terrible they were, etc. And then they asked the person, did you say that? And they say, no, I never said that. I may have like wondered, you know, if what's going on. I didn't curse him out. I didn't say any of that stuff. And then they ask the accuser, they say, well, did you hear him? They say, absolutely. They absolutely said that. And they say, okay, well, you're a believable witness. This other one isn't so believable. We'll believe what you said. So those mock trials, those sham trials, just, they had people simply professional accusers, really, okay? That's how the system works. There's professional accusers who will say in court, they'll say, yes, that person slapped me. You know, they slapped me. Oh, they slapped you? Really? Oh, off with their heads. My gosh. Do you think that my generation is going to worry about someone being slapped? Are you kidding? That's a joke. Nowadays, if someone slapped, it's like a off with their heads. You know, that's so totally bizarre. Oh, someone grabbed my arm. They grabbed my arm and it felt like a strong grip. Oh, off with their heads, you know. I guarantee the older generation is looking at this and saying, what a bunch of absolute knuckleheads, you know, pathetic. But it's because it's all being done for an egoic purpose to establish ego, us as prime creators, you know. That's what it's... The end justifies the means. So the means are sophomoric, idiotic, juvenile, moronic, pathetic. But it's the end that they serve. The end is so important that any means at all seem to be profound, you know. Oh, somebody, you know, shoved me, pushed me a little bit. Oh, God, that's a federal case. Somebody grabbed my hair, you know. Oh, federal case. Somebody laughed at me, federal case. Somebody insulted me, federal case. Somebody used a slur, federal case. You know, my gosh, it is so pathetic. Somebody touched me, and I didn't like the touch. Federal case. That's it. No appeal, you know. Guilty forever. So, it's just, they're simply inventing ways to easily prosecute people and easily send them to re-education. Just inventing ways. They're all making them up. Anyone can do that, you know. I can say, hey, somebody cut me off in a car, you know, and they did it on purpose because they don't like who I am. You know, throw them in jail, you know. Yeah, you're going to invent millions of things, you know. The grocery clerk, you know. They made a comment about the food I was buying. And maybe they think that buying all this kind of food I buy it offended me because they think I'm too much of a health nut or something. And I was very offended by that, really offended. I'm emotional damage, emotional hurt. They're attacking lifestyle, very intolerant of me, etc. And off with their heads, federal case. They're just simply, people are simply inventing ways to be offended so that we can easily, people can be easily and quickly prosecuted, easily re-educated. Why? So that they can agree 100% with made-up facts, opinions that are seen as facts, so that then we can claim that existence is eternal and that we're creators of existence. See, it's all where it's coming from. If you see the root of where it's coming from, then the whole thing, you know, the silliness is exposed. Totally exposed. What are we? Some kind of fragile China, you know? My gosh. What am I? I got a bad bruise on my shin because a garbage can hit me. Boom, because it's my own fault, you know? I'm still clumsy. What am I going to do? Sue the garbage can? Sue the company where it happened? Yeah. Basically, we're taught no personal responsibility. Everyone's a victim. That's what we're being taught now. A Course in Miracles teaches that everyone is personally responsible. There's no such thing as victimization. Okay, that's what the Course in Miracles teaches. Based on facts. Based on facts. Okay. because we are intentionally trying to establish ourselves as prime creators. And victimization is an absolute key way to do this. And so we have a belief, we insist, oh no, we are victimized. We were victimized by some force outside of us that we didn't want that to happen, but it happened against our will, against our intent. And then, so therefore, we have now power over that one who victimized us to do whatever we want to. And what power? To insist that they agree 100% with our opinions about stuff. And therefore, we can all then establish opinions as facts, which will establish existence as eternal, which will establish us as prime creator. That is the chain of illogic, or plausibility, chain of plausibility, which is why the world is going through this madness right now. It's really madness. I mean, the older people, you know, men and women both, there's this notion that women somehow all agree with this victimization stuff. Not true at all. Older women look at this as nuts, ridiculous, you know. It's an idea that somehow there's this sisterhood that all agree, you know, it's all consensus, all agree. Not even true at all. Not true at all. You know, they just say, oh, this is just ludicrous. This victimization status, you know. Everyone's trying to reach this victim status, you know. And they say, what the heck is going on? You know, they know something crazy is going on. But people don't really know why it's going on and the full extent of it, etc. This has been laid out in this video right here. It is literally to establish ourselves as prime creators. And again, in order to do that, we have to establish existence as eternal. In order to establish existence as eternal, we have to establish that there are facts in existence. In order to establish facts in existence, we have to have 100% agreement on opinions. So there's no dissent. In order to have no dissent, we have to get rid of dissenters. In order to get rid of dissenters, we have to identify dissenters. And in order to, and once we've identified them, we have to have justification to put them away or put them down. And in order to justify that, we have to have accusers. And we have to have crimes to accuse them of that justify putting the dissenters away. And in order to do that, we have to get people willing to claim that they've been victimized. We have to pass laws that establish easy victimization. We have to have people to claim that they've been victimized or willing to do that. They're saying, oh, I've been so offended. You know, I've been so offended. Or whatever. And so that is the chain. That is literally the chain. Okay. If you want to start from the top down, our desire was to become prime creator, spirit's desire. In order to do that, how can we be prime creator if we don't have a creation? So this dream of forgetfulness of reality, we're trying to establish this as eternal, not temporary. Because remember, forgetting is temporary, right? We're trying to establish existence as eternal, unending. In order to do that, we have to establish that they're facts, because facts are rest on eternalness, right? You can't have something that's a fact if it's temporary. Okay, so if there are facts, that means the facts are arising in that which is eternal and unending. Okay, so we have to establish facts here in existence. In order to establish facts, we can't have any doubt. How do we do it? You know, that's the question, because there are no facts in existence. It's temporary. How do we do it? We gotta fake it. We gotta use magic. The magic of saying no dissent equals fact. Okay, no dissent equals fact. That is a premise that we have to accept. No dissent equals fact. That's a premise. It's magic. Okay, it's false premise. How do we get no dissent? Get rid of the dissent. Get rid of the dissenters somehow. How do we do it? Re-educate them? Or, you know, and how do we get them in re-education camps? Because they committed crimes. How do we get them to commit a crime? Well, we just make up, you know, easy crime, you know. Someone will say, they gave me a dirty look. You know, I didn't like the look they gave me. Ah, crime. And how did that make you feel? Well, it made me kind of doubt my beliefs, you know. Oh, really? You mean the way they gave you a look and that look made you doubt your beliefs? Yeah, I kind of started wondering, maybe I'm not, these facts aren't really facts. Oh my gosh, that dirty look was really It's really a terrible crime, isn't it? Yeah, because they caused you to doubt. Yeah. Okay, let's the one who gave the dirty look, they need to be re-educated. Really, it gets to that level. Okay, whatever someone claims, someone will say, I'm a 100%er. I totally believe these facts. But one day I was, in class, and this somebody, said something about somebody else, and it made me wonder, about my views. Are my views really right? Are my and I started I felt this little twinge of doubt, And the inquisitor says, "Really?" He says, "Yeah." And who was it? Well, this person. Oh, okay. Now, when you had that twinge of doubt, how did that make you feel? And I said, "Oh my gosh, I felt terrible. I felt like I'm going to be annihilated. Like I'm something terribly wrong with me. It was horrible." And the inquisitor says, "Ah, okay. So that what you heard caused the doubt, and that doubt made you feel terrible emotional distress, right?" They said, "Yeah, it really did." Well, of course, if you believe your identity is based on consensual belief, okay, then if you have any doubt about a consensual belief, you're gonna feel like you're gonna lose your identity, of course, right? But that's insanity. That's the dynamic of insanity. But when you raise insanity to the level of authority, then when you have this person say, "I overheard something and it caused me to doubt my beliefs. It cost me. I only had 99.9% belief instead of 100% belief." And the inquisitor says, "Well, we just can't have that. We need 100% belief." So this person who said that caused you to disbelieve, wow, they're a dangerous person. They're a very dangerous person. We need to call them out. There you go. And of course, people who just don't like you, who will then just make up, say, "Oh, this person, they said something, they did something that caused me to doubt my beliefs." And so really, the office of Inquisition has been set up many times on this planet. Okay, we had the Inquisition during the Middle Ages, right? We had the Inquisition in China and Soviet Union and other places too. You have the office of the Inquisition is set up, and people, it literally comes down to people merely saying that somebody else caused them to doubt their great leader, or doubt the veracity, the 100% veracity of what the great leader has been teaching them. And that's enough for a crime, enough for them off with their heads. That's all that's required. But we've been working, this culture's been working to get to that point. Okay, all these victimization laws and political correctness, etc., is all working to get to that point where someone can just merely say, "This person caused me to doubt my convictions in the great leader and central planning department, and everything they want me to believe is true. They caused me to doubt it." That's all that's required. Boom. So if someone doesn't like you, all they need to say, go to the office of Inquisition and say, "This person caused me to doubt my beliefs." Okay. Just the way they are. They just their body language causes me to doubt my beliefs. Of course, the truth is, since they're believing that something is a fact which isn't a fact, which exists, they're believing existence is eternal, which isn't a fact, that it's impossible for anyone to have 100% belief. Completely impossible. Because the truth is within. So that little doubt is always there. But what they'll do is they'll project it out on somebody else and say, "Somebody else caused that doubt. If they didn't cause it, I wouldn't have it at all. I'd be 100%er." Okay, not true. It's insane. That's an insane position. It's impossible to be 100%er. You can never get rid of truth. Truth is within us. We'll always have some doubts that existence is eternal, that there are facts in existence. We'll always doubt that. So, but when you're taught that other people are to blame for your doubts, you're doubting authority, when you're taught then that that's victimization, then it's, you are literally teaching insanity. You're promoting insanity to the highest levels, which is what we're doing on this planet, which we have already done it. It's in place. It's very much in place. There's just a need for some head people in politics, etc., to sign some laws and to look the other way and to have no restraints on them. As soon as that happens, boom. Inquisition time here. We are literally on the brink of an Inquisition in this planet. Guaranteed. The previous Inquisitions, a lot of people thought it was impossible, it could never happen. And they took it by surprise. They were shocked. "How could this happen in our great country?" they said. "It's crazy, somebody doesn't like me, they go to the Inquisition office saying that I made them doubt their beliefs, and now here I am starving to death in a work camp. That's completely insane. What happened? Took them by surprise. So just because somebody says, well, I don't see it yet, you know, well, were you looking? Were you aware? Were you awake? Were you intuitive? Were you responding to God's grace and intuition and Holy Spirit's guidance? Were you? If not, well, of course it's going to catch you by surprise. You know, you're afraid to put two and two together because you're afraid that you're going to be targeted, first one targeted, you know. I always say I'm number one on the list, you know. I always have been. So that's a good awareness. You know, if you realize you're number one on the list, then, of course, you increase your awareness for options. But if you keep thinking, well, maybe I can scoot by, maybe I can scoot by, maybe I can be seen as a good person, you know, maybe I can fake it, then you're not willing to see it. You think, no, these people are good, they're not doing any bad, there's no problem. Only happens to real bad people. But then, you know, historically, we've looked back on these situations and realized, you know, trumped up charges, or charges that were so ridiculous of simply, you know, of simply somebody feeling some vague feeling like their doubts are, you're causing some kind of doubt in them, where the fact is it's truth that's causing the doubt, okay? But they say, no, it's not truth causing the doubt, it's that bad person's causing the doubt because they don't really believe, and that's enough to convict you of, you know, death sentence, and that's enough to give you a death sentence in those previous inquisitions. Really, I mean, the inquisitions have been terrible. You know, I've studied them. I know all about them. Because I know one is coming in this world again. Worldwide planetary inquisition. Which is why there's been this big effort to spread this whole educational system and victimization teachings all over the planet. Which is why we're having wars now. All this stuff is intended to sweep away any opposition to this inquisition. So that people will be willing to, yeah, turn everybody else in. Says, yeah, my brother, my sister, my aunt, my uncle, my niece, my nephew, they said something that caused me to doubt. So off with their heads. They're willing to do that because they think they're saving the world. They think they're bringing about the creation, a new creation. They're finalizing the creation of this new creation. They're making it real. They'll call it, we're making it real. You know, they'll have slogans and stuff, we're making it real. You know, and if you've studied history, you know this is just history repeating itself, except on a larger scale because of the digital technology that's available now. Where they can digitally, algorithms, you know, finger everyone that has a profile that they want to cull out. Easy. You know. And it'll be a combination of that and accusations, etc. But in order to process all these people, you know, courts are too slow and cumbersome. So there'll be some other means, probably, of just like I said, the digital profile of many people will just be used, you know, real quick. Boom, 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 boom. Here's a million people. We, you know, fingered all them. They're definitely the profile. It's just, you know, no trial at all. You know, that kind of stuff. We can't be a trial, there's too many of them, right? And end justifies the means, right? End is, of course, we're establishing ourselves as prime creators of this wonderful creation of existence. And who cares how we get there? Once we get there, you know, all's well that ends well, right? Except it doesn't end there, does it? No, it only ends when you wake up from the dream, when you exchange premises. It only ends when you wake up to your multidimensional reality. It only ends when you give up the desire, the whim to be prime creator. Exchange it for not trying to be prime creator. It only ends in remembrance of your true identity as the only way existence ends. It doesn't end by becoming real. It can never end by becoming real. So all of this skullduggery and stuff is just a waste of time. It's not justified. It's not justified at all. No justification for it. It's insanity. Attack is never justified. Never justified. Keep that in mind. Attack is never justified. Well, the cat is now here. Does that mean that it's time to stop the taping? Probably. Yeah, we can go on and on and on and on and on, but this is enough. This is enough. All right. Are you offended, cat, that I'm sitting on your seat? Does that cause you to doubt your perfection? No. Cat is not offended. There's no charges from the cat. Cat is not offended. Cat's not happy, you know? Cat's not happy. He says, hey, you know, I kind of want to sit here. But it doesn't feel its identity is threatened by this. Nobody's identity is threatened. It's ridiculous. Our identity is created by the Prime Creator. It's perfect and flawless. We decided to try and change our identity. So our belief is that it's threatened, that we can change it, and that we need to establish a new reality, a new identity, and that anything that doesn't help us establish this new identity is threatening our identity to be. We need to get there. Like, identity is something we need to arrive at, and if someone is obstructing our arrival at it, they're threatening our arrival at our identity. But that's delusion. There's no identity in existence. There's nothing to arrive at. Nothing to arrive at all. Nobody. So nobody's blocking your arrival at identity. You already are what you are. You need to simply drop your efforts to be something different, to change what you are, change your identity. See? This is truth, this is inquiry, and this should banish all falsity. Okay, hold on. Let me just stop this right now. Very great. Thank you.